Ludwig von Beethoven, often regarded as the greatest composer of all time, was an extremely influential figure in the history of classical music. His music stands to be amongst the most analyzed, performed, and recorded music from all of classical repertoire. He has been the face of numerous biographies, documentaries, rap battles, and even some very questionable movie franchises. From being a victim of domestic abuse at the hands of an alcoholic father, to being tormented by hearing loss for most of his life, from being a political revolutionary, to single-handedly catapulting the classical era into romantic, Beethoven's life is nothing short of inspiring. Beethoven suffered more than any person could endure. He was depressive, bipolar, lonely, and paranoid. His body failed him in more ways than one. He suffered from chronic liver disease, diarrhea, and not to mention the growing deafness that haunted him throughout his adulthood. And yet, amidst all the emotional and physical torment, he doesn't give way to despair and retains his optimism, even in the darkest times. His musical works are flooded with themes of hope, love, peace, and unity, making them synonymous to Beethoven's own triumph over life's challenges. The best example of this can be found in his Ninth Symphony. With this, Beethoven profoundly conveys his love for humanity and celebrates freedom, human spirit, and unity of all mankind. He manages to articulate and convey his message with a music so potent and moving that even today, nearly 200 years after its premiere, his symphony stands to be one of the most iconic and appreciated musical works in all of human history. It has become a symbol of hope, freedom, and tolerance, from the fall of the Berlin Wall to becoming the anthem of the European Union. His Ninth Symphony has been a part of several significant historical events throughout the last century, and it still boosts human spirits today, like it did when it first premiered in 1824. Beethoven's Ninth is powerful, beautiful, moving, and stands as a testament to humanity. It fills us with optimism, demonstrates its love for humanity, and makes us believe in the things that its composer himself held so closely to his heart. A composer who, by the way, never heard the symphony himself. Yes, by the time Beethoven finished his Ninth Symphony, he was completely deaf. Saying Beethoven was a talented composer would be a gross understatement. His music was powerful, innovative, and highly expressive. He pushed musical boundaries to limits no composer before him dared to touch, and his music introduced an emotional language no composer before him could communicate in. Beethoven wasn't a person. He was a phenomenon, a force that changed music forever, and whose influence still resonates with the music of today. Today, nearly 200 years after his death, I want to share with you my views on why I think Ludwig von Beethoven is without a doubt the most influential musical figure in all of Western history. He redefined musical expression. One of the most distinctive qualities of Beethoven's music was his ability to emulate profound emotional states in his music. It was distinctive because the classical style out of which Beethoven's musical language grew was one that stressed certain qualities, such as clarity, good taste, and moderation. Unlike his predecessors, Mozart and Haydn, who emphasized the utmost importance of beauty and predictability in music, Beethoven turned classical music over its head by breaking classical rules right and left for the sake of expressing very complex emotional states, from rapidly changing tonal centers to distant keys, introducing complex harmonies, surprising listeners with the sheer unpredictability of his musical structures, to incorporating extremely contrasting dynamic changes, that is, extreme changes in intensity and volume. Beethoven's music was a roller coaster ride for the listeners at a time where simplicity and predictability was the norm. Take a look at the fourth movement of his string quartet number 6, rightly titled La Malinconia, meaning melancholy. Beethoven here uses various unusual musical techniques, ranging from alternating changes of tempo and rhythm to discordant harmonies and strong dynamic contrasts in order to express his depressed state of mind in the most striking way. Another example of this can be seen in the fourth movement from his Pastoral Symphony, with which Beethoven displays the feelings of anger and agitation. This movement depicts a violent thunderstorm, and Beethoven emulates it with painstaking realism, building from just a few drops of rain to great climax with thunder, lightning, high winds, and sheets of rain. The storm eventually passes with an occasional peal of thunder still heard in the distance. The storm eventually passes with an occasional peal of thunder still heard in the distance. From a historical perspective, this form of expression through music was completely out of sync with the times Beethoven grew up in. During the classical era, the ideas of reason, nature, and morality were reflected in the form and structure of music. The focus was on music that was in good taste, was elegant, and would appeal to all listeners. Music of the classical era had to be predictable in order to be popular. The listeners expected to be able to know when the next section of music would begin and when there would be a change in the direction of the music. Music was also required to appeal to a variety of people, not only on a national basis, but on an international basis as well. It also had to appeal to people of all classes. The interweaving lines of Baroque music mostly disappeared, replaced by strong melodies that were reworked and expanded in tuneful phrases with contrasts of sound and constant, well-organized movement from one key to another. I'd like you to listen to this excerpt of Mozart's Piano Sonata in A minor. This is one of the few tragic pieces Mozart wrote in his lifetime, and it reflects a particularly dark phase of his life brought on by his mother's demise. This piece particularly stands out for me because Mozart uses some of the most un-Mozart-y techniques and willingly deviates from his usual writing style in order to express his unrest, anger, and confusion. These include unrelenting pulsating rhythms, asymmetrical melodic phrasings and unclear cadences. Yet, despite everything, Mozart retains the classical ideals and doesn't deviate from the sonata form. Even in his most tragic works, his expression remains of highest beauty and his music upholds the grace and perfection of the musical form. Mozart emphasized the utmost importance of beauty in music, and this piece is the best example of that. Mozart, like most classical composers, warned against trying to express emotions in music in a way that risked sounding unpleasant or exaggerated. He said in a letter, "The passions, whether violent or not, should never be so expressed as to reach the point of causing disgust. And music, even in situations of the greatest horror, should never be painful to the ear, but should flatter and charm it, and thereby always remain music." Compare this to the furious, agitated third movement of Beethoven's Piano Sonata No. 14. Unlike Mozart, Beethoven doesn't hold back from being intensely passionate and uses rapidly progressing notes and intricately assigned changes in musical dynamics to evoke feelings of unrest. This piece is fast and aggressive, and its underlying emotion is conveyed in an intelligible way. I think it's important to stress that this is not meant as derogatory of the emotional content of the classical composer's works, but rather as showing that there is a certain tasteful distance to the emotions expressed, however profound, a kind of musical decorum or etiquette, if you will. In some sense, you connect to the emotions expressed by reading between the lines, as if listening to an immaculately verbalized narrative, where the often very compelling emotive content is implied. Our experience and processing of it is not necessarily any less powerful for it. Instrumental music before the 19th century was considered inferior to vocal music for its inability to convey emotion or concepts. Composers often wrote deep and meaningful music for vocals, whereas instrumentals were strictly just ear candy. Immanuel Kant even argued that instrumental music, or wordless music, was more pleasure than culture, and that it failed to engage the understanding or possess any moral purpose. It was Beethoven that changed this mindset by elevating instrumental music to a position where it was soon hailed as a means to knowledge and profound philosophical and emotional insights. He revealed more vividly than any of his predecessors the power of music to convey a philosophy of life without the aid of spoken text. And in some of his compositions, it is found to be the strongest assertion of the human will in all music. He was an innovator. One could probably pen down an entire book acknowledging all of Beethoven's musical innovations, and it still wouldn't be enough. When Beethoven realized he was losing his hearing, he slumped into a depression which soon turned into a life crisis. He wrote the famous Heiligenstadt Testament in 1802, expressing his desperation and despair and suicidal thoughts. Beethoven states in the letter that the only reason he hasn't given up on life yet is to fulfill his musical destiny, and he won't give up until he's expressed all he had to express through his music. This was the beginning of a radical change of style in his compositions. Many of his new works distanced themselves more and more from the works of his predecessors Haydn and Mozart by becoming grander in scale and more challenging in terms of form and harmony. During his later years, he went back to study the works of Handel and Bach, and although influenced by them in certain aspects, his style became ever more personal, and for many contemporaries, eccentric. One of the major changes Beethoven brought was to the sonata form. The classical sonata style strives to achieve great clarity in its compositions. You have a first theme. Then, a second theme, contrasting to the first. Then a short section experimenting with these themes in different ways. Before the first and second themes return, and the movement is finished with a short concluding section, a coda. Beethoven, particularly in his later style, challenges this concept, and sometimes almost even dissolves it. The sections experimenting with the themes, the development sections, and the coda are expanded to an extent that often changes the proportions of the movements radically. Not infrequently, the effect is that you feel as if you've gone through a lifetime while listening to a certain piece, partly because of this grand scale. Another one of Beethoven's innovations involves the way he used musical motifs. A musical motif is a short rhythmic and/or melodic pattern that keeps appearing in a musical work. Although the use of musical motifs has been common practice throughout musical history, Beethoven uses them in a way like no one dared to use them. In the first movement of his Fifth Symphony, Beethoven makes use of a short, four-note rhythmic motif that occurs many, and I mean many times, in various guises. Here is what the iconic rhythm motif sounds like on a drum. Beethoven described this motif as fate knocking on his door, and it was in reference to the particularly hard time he was going through in his mid-30s. The symphony begins with the motif repeated two times. Followed by its occurrence throughout the movement. I'm going to now play it for you, and I'd like you to watch out for the logo on the right of the screen, which will flash every time the motif occurs. Thank you. Beethoven then reintroduces this motif in the third movement of the symphony, but this time it sounds hopeful and transcendental. This, in my opinion, is one of Beethoven's most astonishing and beautiful musical innovations. By proving that a great musical piece doesn't require a great melody, Beethoven redefined music forever. For a long time, musical expression was linked to beautiful lyrical melodies, but Beethoven changed this entire outlook by taking something seemingly insignificant and unappealing and crafting it in a way that gives logic, emotion, and meaning to a composition that doesn't sound repetitive. This is also a reflection of Beethoven's compositional brilliance and his profound understanding of music. In a world where composers rely heavily on melodic beauty, Beethoven took the smallest musical palette and made something more convincing and touching than any melodically powerful musical work. The symphony then ends with a triumphant fourth movement. Many musical works where he employed such an extreme use of motifs. An example of this would be the extremely famous first movement of his piano sonata number 14. The motif is again a rhythmic motif that sounds like this. The movement is filled with this three-note motif, and Beethoven brilliantly uses it to create a tranquilizing atmosphere that shifts between feelings of rest and unrest through his clever use of harmony. The contrasts in Beethoven's music are another aspect of his musical innovation. He leaps with great confidence from one emotion to another, which is very radically different in a way that would have been seen as alien by his precursors. Part of this is his use of extreme dynamics. Classical composers rarely and infrequently use dynamics, ranging from pianissimo, or very soft, to fortissimo, or very loud. In Beethoven's music, dynamics range from pianissimo, or very, very soft, to fortissimo, or very, very loud, and he used them in quite close proximity. This sometimes creates the effect of a musical narrator, not fully in control of his extreme emotions. A feeling that you rarely, if ever, get with the music of classical composers. An example of this is his symphony titled Wellington's Victory. This symphonic work was so noisy and trite that most scholars consider it an embarrassment. It depicts, with the help of spatially separated brass and percussion effects, a rout of French forces at the hands of the British. Look out for the extreme dynamic changes, but also pay attention to how craftily Beethoven articulated the sonic assault in order to portray battle scenes. A 100 musicians played at the premiere, twice as many as at the first performance of the Eroica Symphony in 1805, with the audience seated at the center. Afterward, someone remarked that Beethoven had written a piece seemingly designed to make the listener as deaf as its composer. He was the world's first rock star. This one isn't so much about his musicality as much as it is about his personality. Beethoven was a complicated human being. He had a fire-filled temper. He was compulsive. He was clumsy. And he was an obsessive perfectionist. But above everything else, Beethoven was a man who knew his worth as a musician and as a human being. He never compromised his ideals, even in the worst political, social, or economic atmospheres, and always stood for what he thought was right. An early advocate of democracy, Beethoven dedicated his Third Symphony, also called the Eroica, to Napoleon Bonaparte, as Beethoven felt he embodied the democratic and anti-monarchical ideals of the French Revolution. This was until Napoleon declared himself emperor, which sent Beethoven into a fit of rage, and he furiously scratched off Napoleon's name from the manuscript and instead dedicated it to one of his patrons. The scratch on the original manuscript can still be seen, and it beautifully showcases how deeply seated Beethoven's political ideals were. Musicians at this time were treated like servants by the aristocrats, and they had no other option than to endure the mistreatment because their livelihood depended on either commission-based work, which was funded by aristocrats, or by securing a position at the court. Even Mozart, who was well aware of his genius, was treated poorly at court and would often have to sit with the cooks. But Beethoven, due to his Enlightenment principles, never fared well with authorities or people of high social rank, and he never shied away from expressing his dislike towards them, even if it meant his actions were hurting his livelihood. Beethoven refused to be mistreated. He demanded to be seated at the head table with royalty. When other musicians arrived at court wearing wigs and silk stockings, he came in commoner's clothes. He refused to play if he wasn't in the mood. When other musicians performed, he talked over them. When people talked over him, he exploded and called them swine. Once, when his improvisations moved listeners to tears, he chastised them for crying instead of clapping. Most musicians would have been fired for this behavior. But Beethoven's talent was too magnetic, and it was because of this that Archduke Rudolf made an exception. Beethoven could ignore court etiquette, he said. Beethoven was confident. He knew he was superior to the ones that paid him, and it was because of this that he refused to abase himself to aristocrats, even as he took their money. In one instance, when he had an argument with one of his patrons, Beethoven said these words, "Prince, what you are. You are through chance and birth. What I am through my own labor. There are many princes, and there will continue to be thousands more. But there is only one, Ludwig von Beethoven. Beethoven refused to make music for anyone but himself. He wanted the freedom to make what he wanted, and when he wanted to. It was because of this that he refrained from doing commission-based work. Luckily for him, he was befriended by many aristocratic patrons who realized his genius and also found themselves drawn to his audacity in not conforming to authority or tradition. Beethoven knew he needed the patronage of the aristocracy, even while criticizing their old-world, non-democratic ruling structure. And so, he put up with the conditions that he would make whatever kind of music he wanted to, without having to adhere to any deadlines. The patrons accepted his conditions, and for the first time in history, a contract was made stating that a musician would be paid a fixed amount of 4,000 florins, about $200,000 in today's currency, every year till his death, regardless of whether or not he made music, with no creative interference from their end. The patrons kept their promise, and thanks to their patronage, Beethoven left behind a musical legacy that was filled with one remarkable musical work after another. In 1827, some 20,000 people filled the streets for his funeral. Schools were closed, and soldiers were called to ensure order. Just 10 years after his death, Bonn celebrated its first Beethoven Festival. Salespeople sold Beethoven neckties, Beethoven cigars, and even Beethoven pants. All of it was groundbreaking. Never before had a musician garnered so much attention. It indicated a larger cultural sea change, a society that reveres artists and makes them celebrities. His music and personality have captured and commanded the imagination of successive generations of composers, performers, and listeners to an extent unmatched by any other composer. In the 19th century, Beethoven became significant with the ideal of artistic originality and the image of the rebellious revolutionary genius. His music influenced almost every composer of the Romantic era, including Schumann, Liszt, Brahms, Chopin, and Schubert. So, was Beethoven the greatest composer that ever lived? No, absolutely not. The world is too huge and music too beautiful for any person to hold that position. But every once in a while, there comes a person that casts a shadow so large that we can't help but feel its shade. And Beethoven was one of them.
Oh!